good to be in the house of the Lord together. Amen. All right. Is everybody glad to be here?
Amen.
Amen. All right. Colt, come on in. He's running into the baptistry. We're just abandoning all safety rules and everything.
We'll just turn around this way. Stand.
Church, as you know, last week, Colt Melton made his profession and faith in Jesus Christ public to you. It's not new to him, but it's gotten to a point where he wanted to make it public, and now he stands before you desiring to be obedient to Scripture and to be baptized. Colt, do you know Jesus as your Savior?
Yes, sir.
Amen. Amen. Colt Melton, based upon your profession in Jesus Christ as your Savior, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I don't know a greater way to start a service than to celebrate the obedience and the following the Scripture and Jesus changing the life. Amen. Church, let me pray for us, and then we'll worship, and I'll join you here in just a few minutes. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this morning. Lord, we thank you for the testimony that Colt has just had. Father, we thank you for the way that you have changed his life through Jesus. We thank you, Father, how he desires to be public about who he lives for, that you are his Savior. Father, I pray that this will be an encouragement to he and to his family, to his church. Father, I pray for those of us here that have been saved and baptized, Father, that we might be encouraged to remember, Father, this moment in our lives. And Father, if there are people here that, Father, don't know you yet, Lord, I'm so glad that they're here. And I pray, Lord, that through Colt's testimony and through the worship and through the word today, Father, that you might draw each of us, Father, closer to you. Father, we thank you for your goodness to us. We pray all this in the great name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Church, we have much to celebrate this morning. Colt said yes to Jesus. You get a chance to say yes by singing, "Yes, I Will." Let's stand as we sing together, "Yes, I Will."
Oh, yes, I will.
Sound really good already this morning, and I hope you take that same enthusiasm to our new worship song of the month. It's a song called Time and Time Again. I really love it. I fell in love with it about a month ago, and I've been excited to be able to share it with you. Let's sing together for the first time, Time and Time Again.
Time and time and time.
He's faithful. We can celebrate that this morning. God bless you. You can be seated.
All right. Good morning. Again, right? You're going, Jeff, you don't feel like you're all the way dressed. Well, Zach, he always picks the shortest worship songs on Baptism Sunday. No. It worked out fine. It worked out just fine. Good to see everybody here. Isn't it good to be in the house of the Lord? And so it's good to see everybody here. Joy, where are you? Where are you? Oh, up in the balcony. All right. Church, Joy Dewson, as I shared with you yesterday, Rick passed away yesterday morning. And Joy, in chatting with some people this morning, said that being with her church family, being in God's Word, worshiping, was like a balm to her soul. And we don't have arrangements yet, but we meet this afternoon, and I'll share that with everybody soon as we know. Joy, I'll take care of sharing with everybody, but we want to pray for Joy and for kids and family and friends. Something like this happens, we're all impacted. It's part of a family. Amen. So, church, continue to pray. Continue to be ready to encourage, walk with, and we'll try to keep you updated as much as we can. But, Joy, I'm so glad that you and family are here. I believe I agree with you. This is where I'd want to be if I was struggling with something as well. And so, good to see everybody. If you're with us online, we're glad that you're here. If you're with us on the phone, we're glad that you're here. And if you're here in person, we are extra special glad that you are here with us. Hopefully, when you came in, you were given a call to action. And just want to point out a couple of things to you. Remember, we have a monthly fellowship Wednesday night meal, and that happens. That meal is this Wednesday. That would be the 10th of April. And if you're planning on being a part of that, we have until 1 p.m. tomorrow to provide our reservation number. And so if you are planning to be a part of that meal tomorrow night, you need to tear this off. You need to fill it out. And then you need to do probably one of the most important things, drop it in the box. We had a couple of people last month and they go, I know I signed up. And then they called me and they go, but I never turned it in. So, church, take care of doing that. I hope you'll become be a part of that. Also, while you're looking at this tear off, if you are a lady of any age, this next announcement is specifically for you. You'll see in here, First Ladies. That's the name of our women's ministry beginning now and moving forward. And there is an informational meeting, a mission meeting, a vision meeting, a ministry gathering of all of our women. This is not a leadership team meeting. This is we're inviting you, if you are a woman and desire to be a part of this, we're inviting you to this tea. You'll notice that it is on Sunday, April the 28th at 2 p.m. You see all the information there. What we need is for you to take the time to sign up, to let us know that you're coming so that this kickoff event will be as exciting as those that have been working to bring it this far are excited about it being. So we look forward to you doing that. Notice Secret Church, we had to purchase all of our information. And if you're going, well, Jeff, I was going to tell you that I wanted to be a part of Secret Church. Well, reach out to me and let me know, and we will work on making sure that that happens. But we have done it. So this is a reminder to you. But if you're interested, I've got a couple, three spots that I bought in advance for you to be able to do that. So I pray that you'll take time to let me know you want to be a part of that. And if you've already signed up, we will be reaching out to you again between now and this event time to be a reminder and as we prepare and look forward to that good time of Bible study. Note, in a couple weeks, we're having a baby shower for Shelby, Taylor, and Drew, and baby Levi, soon to be here. Levi's date got moved up just a hair, which we're excited about, but he's still going to not be here on shower day. Right, Shelby? No Levi before the 21st of April. Okay, that's Shelby's commitment to us, but ladies, you're going to want to be a part of that. And just notice all the other things going on. We're so glad that you are here. Lots of things to follow up on. All right, Children's Church, you can begin to make your way out. I notice Children's Church people in the balcony. I notice them in the vestibule waiting on your children. Last week we had, just as a bit of encouragement and also a bit of a challenge, last week we had 559 people here for Easter service. 58 of them were in Children's Church. Now, that's a few leaders and a bunch of kids. And then we had 50 in the nursery. And that's about 40 kids, to be exact, and 10 helpers. And that's almost an unfair fight, don't you think? And so the Lord has blessed us because our fifth grade and under number just last week was 100. That's awesome. That's scary. Because if we as a church don't surround them and raise them up and do all this. And so if you are on a nursery team or if you are teaching Sunday school or teaching children, I love you, and I am glad that you are doing that, and I want you to be encouraged. The Lord is moving and working. But, church, I also want you to be encouraged, and I want you to sign up to help because we need more in nursery. We need more help because the Lord's helping us grow. Amen? But if we're going to be good stewards of that, we've got to step in, and we've got to help. And so there's a little blank space down here, and you can just write me a little love note down here. It says, Jeff, I love that the Lord is growing our church. I love that we have more than 100 kids. Even though it scares me to death, I will serve. And then put that in the offering box as well with your tithes and offerings, okay? God is good. And when He brings us children, we need to serve them. We need to serve them together. So if you are not yet serving, this is me asking you to take a turn in serving. Amen? All right. Love my church family. Let's stand and we're going to pray with each other. And then after I pray, you'll stay standing and we will worship yet again. And then I'll join you here in just a few minutes. We'll open up God's word again. And as we turn back to the book of Luke, I'm excited about what the Lord has for us this morning. Church, let's pray. Father, we thank you that we're a week after our celebration of Easter. And Jesus is still alive. Father, as we studied in Sunday school this morning, Father, He ascended. And He is now at your right hand. And He is interceding on our behalf. And Father, we need a Savior. We need a Redeemer. And Father, Jesus is the answer. And I thank you, Father, that He stands at the right hand and desires to intercede for all who will come to Him by faith. Father, may that be our desire, whether it be little children, whether it be a little bit older children, youth, adults of any age, Father, may it be our desire as a body of believers to see people come to know the love of Jesus, your gift of redemption and salvation through their faith in Jesus and the eternity that you have for us. Father, may that be what drives everything that we do. And Father, sometimes that's worship, and sometimes that's small group Bible study, and sometimes it's preaching, and sometimes, Father, it is teaching children, watching childcare, being in children's church. Father, sometimes it's talking to our neighbor, our coworker, inviting them, Father, because you are moving and working always. May we desire, Father, to see where you're working and to go right there and faithfully allow you to lead and guide us. Father, I pray that you will open up your word to us in a few minutes and that you will, Father, draw us close to you as we learn more about it. Father, as we worship, Father, may you be the only reason that we worship. For you and you alone, Father, are worthy. Father, may we be singing our praise to you as if it's just us and you. Father, we just pray that you'd have your way in our lives. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Sing it out with us. Here we go.
Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand when everything around me is shaken. Still got joy in chaos. I've got peace that makes no sense, and I won't be going under. I'm not held by my own strength, 'cause I built my life on Jesus, and He's never let me down. He's faithful in season. Yes, He is. So why would He fail now? He won't. He won't. He won't fail. He won't fail. He won't.
what a reminder. Thank you, church. You can be seated.
I love that song. One, because it's true. Amen. Angela and I were at a conference. I think Tony Evans was speaking that night. And the next morning, I was to begin cancer treatments for the first time. And that song was part of the worship set. And it became this mantra of ours all the way through, and it hasn't stopped since then. It's a great reminder. I ask you to take your Bible and turn with me to the book of Luke. The book of Luke, chapter 6, is where we are still at. Put your finger on verse 12. We'll join you there in just a minute. We're going to be going, I've adjusted the scripture that we're going through. We're just not going to read as far this morning, but we will start reading in Luke chapter 12. Using that pew Bible there in front of you, it's on page 1186. Shared a few years ago about Angela and I having some foundational problems in our house. There was this section that you went in, and we had a group of people over, and there was a man who was a part of the church who came over, and he said, I think you have a foundation problem. He noticed something that probably we had just gotten used to, and I think I shared this years ago, and we called and had someone come and look at it, and sure enough, there was an area in the foundation that had lost its security, and so they came in and fixed it with a metal beam and some jacks and all of the technical things that people like that do to be able to do that. Do you know if you don't fix your foundation, your house is going to pay for it? Right? And that became this recurring theme to me, not my physical house in Bellbuckle, but the foundation, as we read today's scripture, the foundation that we as a church are being built upon. If we don't have a good understanding about foundation, then we won't arise and stay strong like we should. And this one verse I just want to share with you, it's not from Luke. I just want you to put it in the background because it sort of becomes the umbrella of which everything that we're going to talk about today fits under. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 18. You can just write that down in your notes. I'm going to read it for you. But 1 Corinthians 12, 18 says this, "But now God has set the members, each one of them in the body, just as he pleased." Now, if you have become a member of First Baptist Church in the last 10-plus years as I've been pastor, one of the things that we have sat down and talked about is, do you know Jesus before you came to know him? And have you been baptized through immersion before membership? And then, do you believe that God wants you to serve him as part of the body of Christ that is called First Baptist Church? Because I believe that Scripture teaches that the Lord knows exactly where he wants us to be and how he wants us to serve and become a part of that. So that's that umbrella that I want to share verse with you that we do that. I'd like us to stand, and we're going to read from Luke chapter 6. I'm going to start in verse 12. That's where we left off last week. And just so everybody knows, I'm only going to read through verse 16, and I know that the guys in the booth, when you get to verse 16, I'm going to stop reading, and you can stop putting it up there, but we're going through verse 16. Luke chapter 6, picking up at verse 12, says, "Now it came to pass in those days that he," that's Jesus, "went out to the mountain to pray and continued all night in prayer to God. And when it was day, he called his disciples to himself, and from them he chose 12, whom he also named apostles. Simon, who he also named Peter, and Andrew, his brother,
James and John, Philip and Bartholomew, Matthew and Thomas, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon called the Zealot, Judas the son of James, and Judas Iscariot, who also became a traitor. All right, thank you, church. You may be seated. Don't worry about those other verses we didn't read. We will pick them up next week as we keep on going through the book of Luke. But verse 12 starts off, now it came to pass. And so if you remember, or if you go back and read in verse 11, Jesus had just had another run-in with the people about the Sabbath. You know, we talked about this a couple of weeks ago before Palm Sunday and before Easter Sunday. So now we're picking back up. And some time has passed between verse 11 and verse 12. And while we're not given what exactly happened during between verse 11 and verse 12, it would be reasonable for us to understand that in this time that has passed, that Jesus had continued to teach, that Jesus had continued to heal, that Jesus had continued to share the gospel, that Jesus had continued to move from town to town, sharing the message of his purpose. I don't think that we're having to stretch too far in order to fill in what happens between verse 11 and verse 12. You see, Jesus had clearly stated his purpose, and I've just flipped back to Luke chapter 4. I just want to read what Jesus said in Luke 4, verses 18 and 19. He was quoting scripture. He said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, the recovery of sight to the blind, and to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord." So it's reasonable for us to assume that if Jesus has continued to teach and go and heal and all of these things that Jesus had been doing prior to our break between 11 and 12, that it's also reasonable for us to conclude that the number of lives that Jesus had impacted, the number of lives that he had touched, the number of people that had begun to follow him was growing, that the crowds had gotten larger. And Jesus had continued to lead and teach those disciples closest to him. Recall, we've studied in Luke already the calling of Simon Peter, Andrew, James, John, and Matthew. We've talked about that just in the book of Luke here lately. Now, we can make the assumption that Jesus had already called more men. We just haven't talked about them specifically in the book of Luke, as the other gospels give us insight to Jesus calling others. And we can hope that they, these disciples that he had called, had begun to grow more, understand more, become more faithful, to become more aware of Jesus' purpose. And we know from the scripture that we've just read today that this growth is what Jesus desires in them. So think about this for a second. He met Peter, and then he has taught Peter, and Peter has walked with him. Remember, we talked a few weeks ago that Jesus has liable, this is liable to have been a year into Jesus' ministry when we get to this scripture. And so he's been walking and teaching people, and you would like to think that Peter, in this example, would have known this much about Jesus, and then by walking, talking, and praying, and Jesus being teaching him, Peter has grown and grown and grown and grown. And so I wanted to stop and ask you, what is your Jesus trajectory? You know, a trajectory is, what is your line? You know, where, if you were to plot your Jesus life, is it one that hopefully began and has just taken off? Or is it one that has sort of gone, I don't know? And we see this, right? We've got these things in our life. You know, Jesus' desire for us, I believe, is when we come to know him, when he changes our lives, when the Spirit of God comes into our life, he desires us to get to know him, to desire him, and then to take off and to never go backwards. I think that's his desire for us in life. I know that that's the desire that I believe he has for me. Ask you a different question. Are you closer to Jesus now than you've ever been? It's a question for you to consider. Because if the answer is yes, then keep it up. Because tomorrow you're going to need to be even more close to him in order for that to stay true. And if it's not true, if you go, well, Jeff, I've been closer to Jesus in times past than I am right now. Well, then I'm especially glad that you're here, because that's not what Jesus wants for you. He wants you back on the path of coming after him. And church, this past Wednesday, we figured out part of the challenge or part of the benefit. We're going through the book of Psalms on Wednesday nights, and this past Wednesday we were on Psalm 63, and in there we talked about how David said in Psalm 63, even though David was going through lots of trials in life, he said, I have a thirst for you, O Lord. And we talked a lot about what that looked like, and a thirst meant eager and desire. And here's my final question in this little piece right here is, do you desire Jesus more today than yesterday? It's a question that we each need to consider. Is he Lord of your life? You see, if he's Lord, he has the authority. He gets to tell you what to do, where to go, how to act, what to think. Is he Lord of your life? So that's just a little offshoot right there of what I believe Jesus wants in our lives to grow closer to him. Verse 12 goes on to say that he went out to pray. So some time has passed, and Jesus goes out to pray, says that he goes up on the mountain there in verse 12 to pray. Now this Jesus, this he in Scripture is Jesus. And you know, if we think about it, it's not hard for us to come up with times where Jesus made spending time with his Father an important priority in his life. This is not the only time that we have heard it, and nor will it be the only time that it occurs in Scripture where Jesus sought after his Father. You know, this is a choice that Jesus is making to say, nope, I'm going to go over here and I'm going to spend time with my Father. To step away from everything else, to prioritize his relationship with the Father. Church, can I tell you that I'm not always as good at making this choice as I should be? You know, it should be easier going, but Jeff, you're the pastor. Surely you come after God all the time. And I'm just here to tell you that, church, that's a choice. That's a choice I need to make every day. That's a choice you need to make every day. And if your trajectory question has a challenge, or if you've ever been closer to Jesus than you've ever been right now, then part of it is because perhaps you're not prioritizing God like you should, like I should. Verse 12 says that when he went to pray, when it went up on the mountain, it says that he continued all night in prayer. Jesus desired to be with his Father. Jesus had a purpose to go before his Father. Jesus, as we've read, was preparing to make some important choices that would shape his ministry, that would shape the church as a whole, and that would indirectly or directly impact me and you. Jesus knew that spending time with the Father would provide the ability to remain in the Father's will in the decisions he was making. Now, I don't know what decisions you need to make in life or what you're mulling over, but I'll tell you this, God has a purpose for you. And he wants you to know that purpose, but that purpose is revealed as you desire him, prioritize him, seek him, and then obey him. And he has this purpose for you. So I encourage you to spend more time. But it says that Jesus prayed all night. Have you ever wanted what God wanted that much, that you're going to pray all night? Jesus did. Verse 13 says, and when it was day, when that night of praying, when that night of Jesus coming before his Father and them spending that time together, verse 13 says that he called his disciples to himself. Now, it's interesting. We need to make sure that we really understand some words here, because if not, we can allow things to become the same. And I think we need to make sure that we always see them as appropriately different. It says here that Jesus got the whole group of his followers together, his disciples. We need to understand that this word used here for disciples is the more generic term for someone who is following a teacher. Haven't we talked over the last few weeks as we've been walking through the book of Luke that Jesus started and then the crowds grew and then the crowds grew and then the crowds grew? We've been following this, right? And more people are believing and more people are coming in contact with him. And those would be simply called disciples, people that are following Jesus. That group could contain people of many different spiritual positions, right? Could that not be true of us this morning? We all would go, yes, I'm a follower of Christ. But yet in our hearts, we are all on different levels of maturity. I spoke with someone earlier this week who said that they were a follower of Christ. And when I was talking with them more and opening up scripture and having conversation with them, we ended up getting to a point where they go, I guess I'm not really yet a follower of Christ. Becoming a disciple is a process. Following Jesus. Some of these people would be considered committed to Christ. Others may not be. It's interesting. If we were to go to the book of John, and we're not going there, but if you wanted to make this scripture note in your note, John 6:66 says this. After Jesus, now this is a summary, after Jesus had shared some hard teaching, and you can go read prior to John 6:66, here's the quote. From that time, many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. Now, church, we need to understand that this is not Peter, James, and John. These are general disciples. Jesus had a group of disciples, and then as he continued to teach and refine them, some people turned and walked away. We've seen that happen here. We have people that used to call First Baptist Church home that don't call someplace home at all. They just aren't here, and they're not anywhere. We see people that fall off in their original desire. And then you keep going in verse 13, from them, from this group of disciples, verse 13 says that he, Jesus, chose 12 whom he called apostles. Now, it's important to know that, as I've mentioned once already, this is about a year into Jesus' ministry. Jesus has known these men that we're getting ready to read about for a while. This is not some kind of who wants to volunteer situation. I mean, Jesus has prayed all night, and Jesus is actively making the choosing. And I don't even know that there's been a campaign going on that everybody knew Jesus was going to do this. I think Jesus is just deciding now, ministry-wise, it is time to amp up God's plan. And I know we read the names, but I wanted to take a... Do you know that I almost skipped these verses? And you're going, yeah, I'm sort of wondering what in the world you're going to use them for anyway. But can I tell you that all of Scripture is good for teaching? And God said, don't you skip this scripture. And in reality, I was going to do this much. And God said, no, you're going to refine it. And you're going to do this much. And so that's where we find ourselves this morning. But I want to tell you that I think it's time that we take time to understand the importance and the responsibility of an apostle. It says here in this that he chose from the 12, from the disciples of a mixed commitment, followers, he chose 12 whom he named apostles. Well, I've shared with you that a disciple is one who follows or would be considered a student. An apostle is defined as one who is set apart, an ambassador, one who is sent out with a message. These apostles, the ones Jesus had prayed over and the ones he has called out, they form what is called the apostolic foundation of the church. Now, I'm going to explain this more, but we need to understand that when Jesus called out apostles, he's calling out a different set of people. And they form the apostolic foundation of the church. These men, these 12, would be the immediate messengers of Jesus to carry out his authority and preach the gospel faithfully. Scripture teaches us that Jesus, in Ephesians chapter 2, 20, is the chief cornerstone of the church. Amen? Jesus is the chief cornerstone. Nothing that is the church without Jesus first being the cornerstone of that church. But it's an interesting thing. When you talk about foundations, you start with the chief cornerstone, but that's not the end of your foundation. You complete the foundation, and I think this is pretty, this means that the very existence and the purpose of the church depend on and flow out of Jesus as the chief cornerstone. But this same scripture, if you go to Ephesians 2:20, says that the apostles are the foundation of the church. Chief cornerstone, and then you build the rest of the foundation around. And Scripture teaches that what Jesus is calling out are the 12 foundations of the church connected to the chief cornerstone. And you're going, Jeff, come on. Write this scripture down. Revelation 21, 14 says, now the wall of the city, this is the New Jerusalem, the new heaven and the new earth. Now the wall of the city had 12 foundations, and on them were the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. Church, we need to understand that what Jesus is doing here in Luke chapter 6 is he is laying the foundation for the church. What we have the ability to do today stemmed from that decision that Jesus made that night in prayer with his Father and made the selection of people, the 12 apostles. Now, the biblical perspective of an apostle carries some very specific qualifications. So let's talk about what an apostle is, because what I want to tell you is there are no new apostles. If you're listening to someone who claims to be an apostle, they are not. They are claiming, there is a beat around today that talks about new revelation, additional fulfillment of God. It is just not true. Scripture teaches in multiple places that God has given us everything we need. It has all been revealed in the totality of God's Word, the Son of God, and the Holy Spirit. And so if you're listening to somebody who claims to be an apostle, you need to defriend them. You need to take them off of your podcast listing. They're not teaching the truth. And you're going, but I like them. Trajectory. Just remember trajectory. But in the New Testament, the apostle refers primarily to those men who were commissioned by Jesus, which we read right here, to represent him in the world and to be his spokesman. Therefore, it is assumed that an apostle walked in close proximity to Jesus in his earthly ministry and was an eyewitness of his resurrection. Now, let me share with you what one of those apostles said in the book of 1 John. I'm just going to go there. If you're going to write this scripture down, 1 John chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. Says this, John, 1 John 1, 1, says, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled concerning the word of life, the life was manifested, and we have seen and bear witness and declare to you that eternal life which was from the Father and was manifested to us, that which we have seen and heard, we declare to you that you may also have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. Did you notice in those verses in 1 John chapter 1, verses 1 through 3, that it is we who have heard, seen, touched, heard, seen, touched. We are sharing with you what we experience so that you can come to know Jesus in this manner. Jesus affirms this foundational approach of the apostle. Think about when he was talking to Peter in Matthew 16, 18. He says this, I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. Jesus is imaging already in his teaching and his scripture. He's saying, Peter, you're going to be one of the foundations that I'm going to use as an apostle. And while Peter means rock, the illustration here is for all of these apostles to be built upon. They're the foundation. This scripture teaches that they, the apostles, receive their teaching and authority from the Lord Jesus himself, and that they mediate the Christ revelation to us. Church, this is the apostolic witness. The apostolic witness is God sent his son. The gospel, we get it because Jesus gave it to the apostles, and the apostles lived their lives faithfully after Jesus ascended, which we talked about in Sunday school today. And we are the benefactors of that. Jesus was laying the foundation for the church in this scripture that we've read this morning. Now, there are a few other apostles listed in the New Testament, including Paul. And you go, well, Paul, he didn't meet Jesus. Oh, yeah, he did on the road. Remember, it tells us right there. And even if you go back and read about Paul's conversion in Acts chapter 9, it's red print. Jesus showed up on the road and he said, you, I will use. So I'm not saying that these are the only ones. I am saying that the ones we hear about in Scripture are the only ones. There are no new ones. So when we boldly share the gospel, we are standing upon the chief cornerstone that is Jesus, standing upon the foundation that Jesus created through the apostles and the gospel message that went out through them. We should have great boldness as we share because our foundation is firm. So I want us to understand this. You go, Jeff, what's your point? This is a significant event. What Jesus is doing right here in Luke chapter 6 is a big deal. And I am guilty, and perhaps you are as well, of going, yeah. Now let's get on to the rest of the teaching. This is in God's Word. This is part of the rest of the teaching. I think that this sets a mindset for us. So Jesus calling these men is a significant event, an event that Jesus has prayed about all night. These men would form the foundation of the gospel moving forward. You can also find a listing of these apostles in Mark chapter 3 and in Matthew chapter 10. John does not show a list of the 12 apostles. He mentions about 7 of them as you read through the gospel of John. And in verse 14 to 16 of today's passage, you're going, Jeff, you finally got here. We did. List these 12 men. I want to tell you what I've done this week so that you'll know what this is, what I'm getting ready to share with you, what it's coming from. I have spent hours this week reading scripture references to different apostles. We get very little information about most, but what information we get is helpful. We get quite a bit of information on some. And that's an important thing. What I have attempted to do is, you know, there's a church history. There's a lot of history about what did Peter do and what did Peter become and how did Peter die. I'm trying to limit what I'm sharing today to what we're given in the Word of God. And so I just wanted to share just a little bit of insight. Simon, also called Peter, hot-headed, hot-hearted, always listed first. The clear leader of the apostles, opinionated, forward, denied Jesus 3 times. Can you imagine one of our foundations denied Jesus 3 times? Likely the source for the Gospel of Mark, and wrote 2 books of the Bible, 1 Peter and 2 Peter. Andrew, Peter's brother. Andrew was an evangelist. If you go and read, Andrew was the first to come to know Jesus, and Scripture tells us that he went and found his brother and brought him to Jesus. That's pretty cool. Andrew, is also the one who found the boy with the 5 loaves and the 5 fishes. and brought them to Jesus. You can also read where some Greeks wanted to meet Jesus, and they came to Philip, and Philip didn't know what to do, so he turned to the one who brings people to Jesus, Andrew, and Scripture teaches that Andrew introduced them to Jesus. Andrew was content to be faithful, but not lead, to be working behind the scenes. James, always listed within the top three of the disciples, which would be James, John, Peter, James, and John. They were the three. He enjoyed a special close intimacy with Jesus. He's the brother of John. He's one of the sons of thunder between James and John. He was a fisherman. He wanted position, right hand, left hand of Jesus, was ambitious, and history tells us that James, this James, was the first to be martyred for his faith. John, the brother of James, the son of Zebedee, many believed was the youngest of all of the apostles. The apostle who lived the longest, he was exiled, we know, to Patmos, known as the one whom Jesus loved. Wrote the Gospel of John, 1 John, 2 John, 3 John, and the book of Revelation. Philip, John 1:43 says that Philip was found by Jesus. Man, we could have a whole sermon over Jesus finding Philip and how if you know Jesus, it's because Jesus found you. Philip, who then after being found by Jesus, went out and found Nathanael, also a disciple. He was a guy who could not, I told you, lead the Greeks to Jesus, but he was faithful, but he was not forward. He was not out front. Bartholomew, brought to Jesus by Philip. Bartholomew's other name by Scripture is Nathanael. He is transparent. He is honest. He is a man with strong prejudice. When he heard about, we have found, when Philip said, we found the Messiah from Nazareth, and he said, can anything good come out of Nazareth? He was prejudiced. And I mean that in the best and possibly worst manner. But he came to know Jesus. Matthew, a tax collector, we've talked about him before he met Jesus. Many felt he was a betrayer of his country, but he introduced his friends to Jesus. Wrote the Gospel of Matthew, was humble in his own gospel. When he included his name in the list, he wrote a publican, tax collector, beside his own name. Thomas, perhaps the most maligned of all the disciples, the doubter, doubting Thomas. But he was fearlessly devoted to Christ. I will tell you this, that Thomas probably was the one you could count on to say what everybody else was thinking. You know people who are doubters? Thomas just needed to test the truth before believing. That's a biblical principle for us to test the spirits. But when he found out and when he tested, he was the one who said, my Lord and my God. He is the only disciple that ever called Jesus God. James, the son of Alphaeus, if you do your scripture homework, you'll find out, like I did, that he's likely the brother to Matthew, because if you go read about Matthew coming to know Jesus, he is the son of Alphaeus. And do I know that genetically speaking, this is the same Alphaeus and they are brothers of each other? No, but I think it's a pretty cool coincidence, and it would not be the only list of brothers that Jesus went after. He was possibly a tax collector, we don't know. He was under the radar, we know very much about him, very little about him, but he worked in the background. This one's cool. Simon the Zealot, Zealotos. We're not given a single word or deed in Scripture about Simon the Zealot except the fact that he was a zealot. And so we can deduce that because he was a zealot, he was a rebel. He was a lover of country, who became a lover of Jesus. And because of his rebel attitude, when he got connected to something, he was willing to give everything for it. And think about this relationship Jesus is creating. You got Matthew, who they thought was a betrayer of country as a tax collector for Rome, and Simon the Zealot, who is a protector of country. They're serving together. Isn't that strange? Church, there's a great point coming. Judas, the son of James. In the book of Mark, he's called Thaddeus. In the book of Matthew, he's called Labius. In John chapter 6, verse 71, he's called Judas, comma, not Iscariot. Have you ever, do you happen to have the same name of somebody who's really bad? That's tough. That's where you get the name Bubba. Don't call me Judas anymore. My name's Bubba. Why? Well, I got tired of being called Judas. Everybody thought I was him. Judas, the son of James, not Iscariot, also Thaddeus, also Labius, had a question for Jesus. It's all we're given about him in John 14, 22. How is it that you manifest yourself to us and not to the world? It's a very future apostle-driven question, don't you think? So you're revealing things to us so that we can then reveal things to the world. Pretty cool. And then Judas Iscariot. It's an interesting thing. When you go read about Judas Iscariot, about every, because we do recognize that the Gospels were written after the events that they write about. We get that. So they now know that Judas is a real skunk, all right? They know he's a traitor. And every time they write about Judas, every time these Gospel writers write about Judas, Judas the traitor, Judas the betrayer, he's known for that forever. You know what's cool, though? I believe it validates Scripture that Judas the betrayer, written about after the fact, was included in the gospel accounts all the way through. It would have been just as easy to go, I'm not writing about him. He's always listed last in the Scripture list. Jesus calls him the son of perdition. He betrayed Christ. He committed suicide. Important fact, do you know none of the disciples saw this coming? Remember when Jesus said, one of you in the room is a betrayer? What'd they do? They all didn't go, it's him. No, every single one of them said, Lord, is it I? Lord, is it I? Do you know that Judas, he surprised everybody when he betrayed? That's an important thing to understand, trajectory. Judas chose Satan over Jesus. Church, I don't know about you, but this listing of apostles looks like us. A people gathered together with various personalities, different backgrounds, different education, different gifts, different strengths, different weaknesses. These apostles look to me just like real people. People that Jesus loved, taught, sent, and called. None of these men were perfect. But I kept asking myself, why Judas Iscariot? Why Judas Iscariot? Church, after Jesus prayed all night, after seeking God, being sovereign, knowing everything, Jesus still chose Judas to be an apostle. So I spent more time reading and reading and trying to get through this personally myself. About why. And while we cannot truly know everything, we can know the following, and I believe that these are biblically true things that we can know. Why did Jesus choose Judas Iscariot to be an apostle? Because it was his sovereign will to do so. Psalm 135, 6 says, whatever the Lord pleased, that he did in heaven and in earth. So we know beyond a shadow of a doubt, the reason Jesus chose Judas is because he wanted to. But there's more. Because it was needful to fulfill Old Testament prophecies concerning every aspect of Jesus's life and mission. Jesus quoted scriptures for telling the same. Knowing the end from the beginning, God was able to record what Judas would do centuries before he was born. Judas fulfilled scripture. And that prophecy was about Jesus. Why did Jesus choose Judas Iscariot? Because Judas would reveal, church, catch this, that association with the godly is possible without regeneration. Think about that. One can be in Christ's service and not know Jesus as their personal Savior. Matthew chapter 7, Jesus talks about this. There were people that come before him and he said, Jesus, we did this in your name and we did this in your name and we did this in your name. And Jesus said, but I never knew you. Church, it matters if Jesus knows you or not. Why did Jesus choose Judas? Because Judas taking the money to betray Jesus would demonstrate that the love of money is the root of all evil. Can you imagine being Judas and Jesus is teaching about the root of this and he's teaching about do not steal and he's teaching about all these things and Judas is in this... He's in this moment of trying to determine what he's going to do. Because Jesus desired to manifest his amazing forbearance and long-suffering. He did not expose Judas, even as he saw his gradual degeneration, but allowed him to reveal his true character. Aren't you glad that Jesus is patient? I don't know your true pathway, your trajectory, but possibly some of our trajectories in the room have this period of time where they don't look very godly. But Jesus just waited for you to find him as he was looking for you to pull you back out. It's a great reminder. Why did Jesus choose Judas Iscariot? Because the sorrow that our Lord's, because of Judas's choice, was necessary to the completion of his qualifications as our high priest. You remember in Hebrews chapter 2, it points that he was tested as we are in everything, including betrayal. I liked this one because even though Jesus knew and saw Judas's evil tendencies, Jesus must have seen many fine qualities in Judas that Jesus believed if Judas would just yield to Christ, that Jesus could make different in his life, that Jesus could make him godly. Jesus no doubt knew the struggle going on in his heart, and he hoped that Judas would be victorious. You know, Scripture says that the Lord wants none to perish. Aren't you glad not only that Jesus is patient, but that he's optimistic? That he goes, I know what I can make out of that rascal Jeff if he'll just but keep his eye on me. But yet this rascal Jeff retains the free will to take my eyes off of him. Which leads to the last point. Why did Jesus choose Judas Iscariot to be an apostle? Because Jesus provides man free will. and he will not then nor today override that freedom, even if it causes one to be separated from God forever. God is loving. God is just. He desires and has shown his love on the cross at Calvary to bring all men into a right relationship with him, but he will not force any man. And church, we need to understand that what that means is that Judas had a choice. He had a choice. He was not some character written in God's plan that was going to be disposable. Because, see, then we get into the character of God issues. Judas had a choice. I read a quote by Herbert Lockyer. He wrote this in 1972, but it caused me to take pause. I'll read this. He said that while we take up great time wrestling with the problem of why Jesus chose Judas, let us not fail to turn ourselves and consider the equal problem of why Jesus called us into his service. What did he see in you and in me constraining him to set his love upon us? Did you ever pause and wonder why Christ, in his matchless love, brought you into fellowship with him? The church today has a great privilege to stand firm on the unshakable foundation of the church and pass the truth of the gospel on to others as it has been passed down to us. Knowing that the gospel has been anchored to the chief cornerstone, Jesus, and then founded on the obedient acts of the apostles, we should have great boldness as we share the gospel. Church, you do not stand on anything but the cornerstone of Christ, the apostolic process. And then we are called to be faithful to share the message. We don't get to be the creators of the message. Aren't you glad? We are just seeking to be the sharers of the message. And so these list of men are critically important. Then, historically up to now, and I pray that you see how they are valuable now, because here's my final point that I want to make. Jesus pulled together some of the most ragtaggiest people you could ever imagine. And then I said, Lord, that looks just like the family you got me heading about. We are just a ragtag group of people that we have one thing in common. One thing in common. You know, we've got people here that are on this side of the spectrum and on that side of the spectrum. We've got people who believe this and believe that. We've got people that are out front, and we've got people that they'll work hard, but they don't ever want to be known about. Can I just tell you that the way God has put the church together is an outstanding thing, because the body, the way he's put it together, which I started with this morning, is an awesome thing. Do you know what it requires? If Jesus is going to be the cornerstone, and then the gospel is founded on the apostolic vision, and then the church grows off of that, it requires that we, a bunch of ragtag people with experiences and differences and challenges and weaknesses and strengths and gifts, that we come together and we agree that we will be used as the body of Christ for the furtherance of the gospel in the life that he gives us. Amen? That's what I want to see Church First Baptist become. But First Baptist doesn't become that. First Baptist is the recipient of that when the people of First Baptist become that. And that's why I'm proud to see what God is doing. That's why I want to tell you, 50 kids in the nursery, God's finding people and bringing them to him. Some of our roles need to be in the nursery. All of our roles need to be sharing the gospel. Amen? Awesome list. Teaches us a lot. Church, I'm going to ask you to stand with me. I pray this encourages you to read more, study more, understand more, but I want you to understand there is not any part of Scripture that we can go, I don't need that. Don't pass anything, church. Just stay. Stay faithful. Amen? Let's pray, because I'm not sure how God is moving and working. I just know that He has promised that He is moving and working. I pray that you let Him have your way. Let Him have His way in your life. Let's pray. Father, we come before You and we thank You for Your goodness. Father, we thank You for these 12 apostles that You chose, Father, that You invested in, that You gave the foundation of the church to. Father, they are only what they are because of You. And everything that comes from them, Father, is founded upon You. And I pray, Lord, that this church, its body of believers, and each individual family and each individual person, Father, we would allow ourselves to be founded upon You. Lord, I thank You for the body of believers. I thank You for the church family that You have allowed me to be a part of, Father, some of the most precious people I have ever met. But, Father, there are also some of the most called, gifted, hardworking, unique people. And I pray, Father, that You would help us to grow up and accept who You want us to be individually, and that You would form us together as a dynamic body of believers that can impact Bedford County for the gospel. Father, I pray You'll have Your way in our lives right now. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Jesus. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for this beautiful day you've given us today. We thank you for this time that we've had to come and give you our worship and praise. We thank you for a great time of Bible study and time of worship, and for an awesome pastor and our staff and worship team. We just have so much to be thankful for in our church, Father. We thank you for the way you're growing our church. And we ask you, Father, to please bless the tithes and offerings that have been brought to you today, that you would use them in a mighty and powerful way to grow your kingdom. And Father, we lift up Miss Joy and her family to you, and ask you to use us to help bring comfort and peace to her and her family during this difficult time. And we pray that as we go our separate ways today, Lord, that you would use each of us as you see fit to bring honor and glory to you. And we lift high the name of Jesus, and it's in his name that we pray and ask these things. Amen.